common, and then as the night goes on, we'll get stranger and weirder, and the ones I don't talk about too often. For one reason or another. I do a little podcast called Realm of the Weird. It's like the weirdest stories that have ever happened to me, and then people always say, like, well, why don't you make more? And I'm just waiting for weird stuff to happen to me to make more. I'm not making these. People are like, that can't be real. And I'm like, no, it's real. And they're like, just make up more. And I'm like, no! And trust me, they're going to happen anyway. You just have to have patience. So, this client called me. Him and his wife had bought a house. I can actually use, on the podcast, I have to, like, change the names. But here, plus it'll make it a little more personal for you when I say where it's at and give you streets and locations, because most of you know what I'm talking about. They had just bought a house in Hazel Park. And they thought that one of the rooms was haunted in the house. There was one room upstairs that looked like it had been a child's bedroom. And whenever you went into that room, anybody, including me when I went there, and I don't really think that I'm, even though people tell me all the time that I'm sensitive or have some kind of pickup for it, I don't think so. But when I went into that room, everyone that went into this room would get this overwhelming sense of grief. It just hung on you. And so I was like, okay, there definitely seems to be something going on. So I do what I do as a researcher, and I look at the house, I look at the property, I look at the former owners, and I start contacting the former owners and the city commission and the public works people to see what has happened in this house to make this room, because I was sure that something terrible had happened in that room. And I couldn't find anything. I talked to 4 different families that had owned the house since the time that it was built. And when I was talking to the 4th family before the new owners, the only person I could find was a woman who had been a little girl when she lived in the house. And she refused to talk to me about that house. So that was my first clue that that's the family I need to be talking to. But of course, since she's my only point of contact and she refuses to talk to me, there's nothing I can do about it. And so I tell the family that's living there now, like, I think something's here, but I can't prove it because the one person won't tell me what's going on. So a couple weeks go by, and I get a phone call from that daughter who had lived in the house. And she said, I want to talk to you about that house and that room. And I said, oh, like, she knows exactly what's going on. What happened? And I was convinced that she was going to tell me that someone either committed suicide or was killed in that room. Just, it was oppressive. And she said, I don't like to talk about it. When I was a little girl and I was bad, whatever my dad thought was bad, he would lock me in the closet in that room.
OMG.
And he would leave me in there, sometimes for days.
OMG.
And I would just sit with my fingernail and carve little people and flowers all along the floorboard in the closet. That's why I don't want to talk about it. So I thanked her and we talked. It was obviously a lot longer conversation than that. After I hung up the phone with her, I thought, but she's in the wrong room because there's no closet in that room. So I go back to the couple's house, we go upstairs, we go into the room, and we start knocking on the walls. And I'm like, there's a closet behind this drywall. We rip the drywall down, and there's a closet door behind the drywall. And I walk in, and all along the floorboards, there's little people and flowers carved in. As soon as we rip the wall down, as strange as I can say this, I started laughing. I was like, I knew it was there. And I just like started laughing and he thought that I was being silly and he started laughing. And we realized like all of a sudden that room wasn't oppressive anymore. Like immediately. And I was like, I wonder if just opening that door like released whatever energy was trapped in there. So we talked about it for a little bit and I drove home. And when I got home, I had a message on my answering machine from that daughter. And she said, Mr. Tenney, I don't know what it is. Maybe it's because I told you. But about an hour ago, I don't care. It doesn't matter anymore. I feel like all of the worry I've spent my whole life wow. has just kind of disappeared. And it was right at the same time that we had opened up the closet for the first time. So as ghost hunters, the thing that fascinates me is we talk about when people die, they leave something behind, a residual energy, or a person sticks around. But here was a case where the person had left behind a ghost of their former self while they were still alive. So when I go to places sometimes and they're like, I see a little girl here, but there was never a little girl that lived in the house. It's very possible that that little girl is still alive somewhere and walking around. And that was the place she not only, I mean, that's the thing too, it doesn't mean that you have to hate the place. We've done investigations and Andrea can tell you, sometimes people go back to the place they loved the most. They'll have a rough life in later years, and so you'll see little images of them when they used to go back to their aunt or uncle's house. So that's the first kind of little ghost story for me.